Ladies and gentlemen, if I could have your attention just for a few moments before Mass begins. My name is Thomas Wilson. I'm the director of music here at St. Mary's Cathedral. And it's my job, along with the organist and cantor, to assist you in the singing of God's praises for the coming Mass. A wise man once said that anyone who sings prays twice. And so the singing of the responses is very much an important part of our participation in the Eucharist. I hope that everyone has been given one of these booklets. This booklet contains all of the music, all the sung and indeed spoken responses for Mass, and you'll find it very useful indeed. I just want to familiarize you with some of these sung responses. All of them are designed to be as simple as possible. You'll see, looking on page 5, under the heading Order of Mass, we have a simple line of music and words under the title The Processional Chant. And we'll sing this chant in between verses sung by the cantor as the archbishop and concelebrants process to the altar. So I'm going to sing the line once to you, and then I'd like us all to sing it together.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, for the mercy and love he has shown us.
Let's sing that together.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity.
Turning over, you'll see music for the Kyrie, or the Lord have mercy. This is very simple indeed, and in fact the cantor sings the line, Lord have mercy, and then we all just repeat exactly what he sings. On the facing page, you'll see under the heading of Gloria, the music and words for the refrain for the hymn, Glory to God in the Highest. This refrain should be known to most of us, as it comes from Brother Colin Smith's Mass Shalom, and I believe that that is still well known throughout the Archdiocese. However, I'll still sing it once, and then we'll all sing it back together.
Glory to
Responsorial Psalm, and again, it's just one simple line of words and music. It goes like this.
Happy are the people the Lord has chosen as his own.
We'll sing together.
Happy are the people the Lord has chosen as his own.
A few pages on, you'll see under the heading Liturgy of the Eucharist, the words and music for the offertory chant. These, like much of the music for Mass this afternoon, are from what we call the propers. Those are the specific texts set in the Missal for Trinity Sunday, which is today. This hymn tune might be familiar, even though the words may not be. It goes like this.
Blessed be our God and Father, blessed be his only Son, blessed be the Holy Spirit, God is three and God is one.
Let's sing that together.
Blessed be our God and Father. Blessed be his only Son. Blessed be the Holy Spirit. God is three and God is one.
Over one more page, you'll see the music for the Sanctus, or Holy Holy. And this setting is designed to be as simple as possible, and even for you to think that you might know the tune once you hear it, even though you might be hearing it for the first time. I'll sing you the first line of music, and then we'll sing it all together. After Holy Communion, we'll sing together the tune by Beethoven known as Ode to Joy, with words again specific to Trinity Sunday. Music at Mass is at essence a dialogue. Firstly, of course, a dialogue between the celebrant and us, the congregation. So when the Archbishop sings, "The Lord be with you," it's our job to sing, "And with your spirit." And from that dialogue, all the rest of this music should flow. So perhaps now we'll just keep some silence until the sacristy bell rings and we stand to sing our processional hymn. Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, for the In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Welcome on this Trinity Sunday to our celebration of the Sacrament of Confirmation for parishes of the Eastern Deanery. I decided this year that I'd invite you all to my place rather than me coming to yours for confirmation, so that our young people might have an experience of the bigger church, of that family of families, that diocesan community of communities that is the church in Sydney, itself in turn part of the universal church. I acknowledge celebrating with me today auxiliary bishops Terry Brady, Tony Randazzo, and Richard Umbers, and also Father Peter Hearn. I welcome all the sponsors and families, teachers, and catechists who are with us today. And to all of you, my young friends, who will be receiving this sacrament this afternoon, I say a very warm welcome. Conscious that the sacraments of baptism and confirmation are calls to each of us to be saints for our world, we repent of the times we failed to live up to those sacraments. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my fault, my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Adore your unity, powerful in majesty.
Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Put this question to the ages that are past, that went before you. From the time God created man on earth, was there ever a word so majestic from one end of heaven to the other? Was anything ever heard? Did ever a people hear the voice of the living God speaking from the heart of the fire as you heard it and remain alive? Has any God ventured to take to himself one nation from the midst of another by ordeals, signs, wonders, war with mighty hand and outstretched arm, by fearsome terrors? All this that the Lord your God did for you before your eyes in Egypt? Understand this today, therefore, and take it to heart. The Lord is God indeed, in heaven above as on earth beneath, he and no other. Keep his laws and commandments as I give them to you today, so that you and your children may prosper and live long in the land that the Lord your God gives you forever." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Everyone moved by the Spirit is a son of God. The Spirit you received is not the spirit of slaves bringing fear into your lives again. It is the spirit of sons, and it makes us cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself and our spirit bear united witness that we are children of God. And if we are children, we are heirs as well, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, sharing his sufferings so as to share his glory. This is the word of the Lord.
The 11 disciples set out for Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had arranged to meet them. When they saw him, they fell down before him, though some hesitated. Jesus came up and spoke to them. He said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, make disciples of all the nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to observe all the commands I gave you, and know that I am with you always, yes, to the end of time."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Your Grace, the parents of each candidate and the parish priests present these candidates for the sacrament of confirmation and testify that they have been prepared and are ready to receive the sacrament of confirmation. We request that you confer on these candidates the sacrament of confirmation.
Thank you.
Baptism is obvious. It's about washing. A special washing, of course, in which our old sinful nature is cleansed and we're given a fresh, godly start. Our beginning experience of grace, faith, church. Holy Communion is fairly obvious too. It's about eating. A special eating, of course, an extraordinary participation in Christ's Last Supper, when he gave us his all, even his body and blood, to be part of us. Reconciliation is demonstrably about forgiving. A spiritual, special forgiving, of course, when we confess our sins to God through a priest and are reconciled to God, each other, and ourselves. Matrimony and holy orders are obviously about committing. A special committing, when we give ourselves to each other in service as man and wife, man and church, and are received and loved in return. Holy anointing is obviously about healing. A special healing, of course, when we are sick of body or soul and brought therapy and a promise of eternity. Mysterious as they are, all these sacraments are enough like ordinary life that we can make some sense of them. Washing and eating, loving and forgiving, curing and caring. It's just that when God is doing these things with us and in us, they are extraordinary graces, not just ordinary life. But confirmation, that's surely the hardest sacrament to explain, even for a bishop. Well, let me try. Today I want to suggest to you that confirmation is a sacrament that renews and promises all the other sacraments, all at once. Baptism is, of course, the sacrament of beginning, initiation, formation, foundation. But so is confirmation. It gets you going. We heard in our gospel today that Jesus sent his disciples out to tell his story to all the world, to be his loving hands and heart, reaching out especially to those in need, to make disciples and baptize them in the name of the Most Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But first, he sent them the grace of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, so they'd have the wisdom and courage to be his witnesses to the whole world. Without such a push and empowerment we call grace, we wouldn't dare do such things. But with that grace, even 10 and 11-year-olds on the cusp of Christian adulthood can share Jesus with the world around them. So confirmation is a bit like rewashing, like second baptism. Like Eucharist, however, confirmation is a sacrament of eating together, connecting, communion. There were people from many countries and languages at the first Pentecost, and at first they didn't understand each other. But then the Holy Spirit came and they could. The Eucharist is like that, especially in places like Sydney. It brings people from every background to celebrate a common faith and hope and love. We receive the body of Christ into our bodies, the blood of Christ into our hearts, so that we might be united with him and with each other. We become that which is presented to us at Holy Communion, the body of Christ. It's the Holy Spirit who does that to the bread and to us. Confirmation then is like First Communion all over again. As Christ gives himself to you and you give yourself to him to be changed. But things fall apart. We've got big ideals, but sometimes we fail to live up to them. We've got important relationships, but sometimes we let each other down. We've got God in our lives, but sometimes we offend against his law or just neglect him. How to get back together with our ideals, our people, our God? Through confession, that sadly neglected sacrament of reconciliation. In that wonderful moment of absolution, the priest says to us that God sent the Holy Spirit among us for the forgiveness of sins. And by that Spirit's power, I absolve you from your sins. At the first Pentecost, the apostles were healed of their apostasy and betrayal, their cowardice and confusion, and restored to God's grace and their friendship with each other. So confirmation today is like re-forgiveness, second reconciliation. Confirmation is also like marriage and ordination, because it's about commitment. We give ourselves to God, to our highest ideals, to the service of humanity. We say to our family, our friends, the church, the human race, I am yours, all yours, for better or worse, for richer or poorer. I am an adult Christian now, ready to commit to big things. But will I see them through? Only by God's grace. So confirmation is pre-ordination, pre-marriage. It gets us ready for more and better loving. And then there's our final anointing, the sacrament of completion. We use holy oil at the beginning of our adult life in confirmation and at the end in holy anointing of the sick. Oil on the body massages, moisturizes, soothes, embalms. So whatever is hurting in your life, torn, broken, bring that to the Holy Spirit for healing. Already in your young lives, my friends, there is room for mending. There will be more bumps and bruises in the years ahead. Anytime you experience hurt in your body or heart, call upon the Holy Spirit's power. Confirmation is the promise that in the hard times ahead, when you need God's grace to get through the hardships, sickness, even death, he will be there for you. So the Holy Spirit comes again and again through word and sacrament, and especially today in confirmation. He wants to be part of your life, and so he keeps coming back to you, promising you gifts like wisdom and courage that can be fruitful in your character and life if you are open to this. And so, my young friends, there's a lot packed into this sacrament of confirmation. A lot of which we are reminded, and a lot more of which we're promised. God wants all this for you because he loves you so much and has big plans for you. Take part wholeheartedly in the rest of the Christian life, and you'll be amazed what can happen in you, with you, and for you. Saint Augustine of Hippo spent 30 years working on a book about today's feast, about the Holy Trinity. One day he was walking on the beach, pondering how he could explain something so profound in human language. And then he saw a boy, perhaps the age of some of you here, or even younger, running back and forth from the water's edge to a spot on the shore. The boy was using a seashell to carry water from the seashore back to his hole and pouring the water in. The great doctor of the church asked him what he was up to. "Oh, I'm moving all of the sea from there over to my hole," he explained. "But that's impossible, dear child," the bishop answered. "The hole cannot contain all that water." The boy paused for a moment, then looked the saint straight in the eye and said, "It's no more impossible than what you're trying to do, to comprehend the immense mystery of the Holy Trinity with your small intelligence. By God's grace, from the mouths of the young, great wisdom can emerge. And by that same God's grace, great things may happen in their lives. And so, my fellow bishops and priests, sponsors, teachers and catechists, family and friends of our candidates, today they will receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Help them apply those gifts in lives of Christian faith and practice, of virtue and holiness, of the worship of God and love for all. Candidates for confirmation, when you are anointed today, you'll receive all you need to lead an adult Christian life, a holy, joyful life. In return, God wants you to give him a gift too. He wants you to share him with others. It's a big responsibility, but I know you can do this big thing. You can do this by who you are and what you say. By praying, coming to Mass and confession, and doing good things in our world. The Holy Spirit will make this possible. So now I invite those who are to be confirmed to stand up and profess your faith in the God who is one and three, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Since it is a Sunday, I invite all of you present to join our confirmands in standing and professing your faith. And so I ask you all, do you renounce Satan and all his works and all his empty promises? Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
Amen.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who today, through the sacrament of confirmation, is given to you in a special way, just as he was given to the apostles on the day of Pentecost?
Amen.
Do you believe in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
Amen.
This is our faith. This is the faith of the Church. We are proud to profess it in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Dearly beloved, let us pray to God the Almighty Father for these his adopted sons and daughters, already born again to eternal life in baptism, that he will graciously pour out the Holy Spirit upon them to confirm them with his abundant gifts and through his anointing conform them more fully to Christ the Son. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who brought these your servants to new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, freeing them from sin, send upon them, O Lord, the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Give them the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and fortitude, the spirit of knowledge and piety. Fill them with the spirit of the fear of the Lord, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. stand. My dear brothers and sisters, let us humbly pray to God the Almighty Father and be of one mind in our prayer, just as faith, hope, and charity, which proceed from his Holy Spirit, are one.
For these his servants, whom the gift of the Holy Spirit has confirmed, that, planted in love and faith and grounded in love, they may bear witness to Christ the Lord by their way of life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For their parents and sponsors, that by word and example they may continue to encourage those whom they have sponsored in the faith to follow in the footsteps of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who prepared them for this sacrament, that the Spirit of knowledge may continue to work through them in their mission, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Holy Church of God, together with Francis our Pope, Anthony our Bishop, and all the bishops, that gathered by the Holy Spirit, the Church may grow and increase in unity of faith and love until the coming of the Lord, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the whole world, that all people who have one Maker and Father may acknowledge one another as brothers and sisters, without discrimination of race or of nation, and with sincere hearts seek the kingdom of God, which is peace and joy in the Holy Spirit, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our communities, that the Spirit of wisdom and understanding may help us to welcome and adore Jesus, the bread of life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O God, who gave the Holy Spirit to your apostles and willed that through them and their successors, the same Spirit be handed on to the rest of the faithful, listen favorably to our prayer and grant that your divine grace, which was at work when the gospel was first proclaimed, may now spread through the hearts of those who believe in you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice.
Sanctify by the invocation of your name, we pray, O Lord our God, this oblation of our service, and by it make of us an eternal offering to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. In a trinity of one substance. For what you have revealed to us of your glory, we believe equally of your Son and of the Holy Spirit, so that in the confessing of the true and eternal Godhead, you might be adored in what is proper to each person, their unity in substance and their equality in majesty. For this is praised by angels and archangels, cherubim too and seraphim, who never cease to cry out each day, as with one voice they acclaim. You accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, Terry, Tony, and Richard, my assistant bishops, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servants and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and the hope of health and well-being, in paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we offer you also for those reborn in baptism, whom you have been pleased to confirm by bestowing the Holy Spirit, and in your mercy, keep safe in them your grace. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest, in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, All glory and honor is yours forever. Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, coming of our Saviour Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to shed my blood. Only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. receiving this sacrament, O Lord our God, bring us health of body and soul. As we confess your eternal Holy Trinity and undivided unity, through Christ our Lord.
Good afternoon, everyone. Archbishop Anthony, Bishop Terry, Bishop Tony, and Bishop Richard, candidates, sponsors, family, and friends, today a memory has been etched into our minds forever. We have been fortunate enough to receive the gifts and fruits of the Holy Spirit as a group of young Catholics coming together to celebrate our confirmation, bonding us forever. The gifts and fruits have been sent to us by God to be used in the right way, so we can live like Christ. We pray they grow stronger each day as we put our faith in God and the Holy Spirit. And now, on behalf of all the candidates, sponsors, family and friends here today at St. Mary's Cathedral, we would like to thank you, Archbishop Anthony, Bishop Terry, Bishop Tony, and Bishop Richard, for helping us complete our journey in the sacrament of confirmation, and ask that you accept these cards as a token of our appreciation. Thank you.
Once again, we thank His Grace, Bishop Terry, Bishop Richard, and Bishop Tony. It has been a wonderful experience celebrating this very special sacrament at St. Mary's Cathedral. Just a reminder to all parents, please note all confirmed candidates will be dismissed from the crypt. Once Mass has concluded, all confirmed candidates and sponsors will follow His Grace and bishops down the aisle and turn right to make their way down to the crypt. Candidates are to have their name marked off in the crypt before being dismissed. Parents and families, we ask you to please remain seated, and once all the children and sponsors have left the cathedral, you may exit via the side doors and make your way down to the external entrance of the crypt to collect your child. Thank you.
If I might echo those words of thanks from our children, for all those who contributed to this beautiful celebration today at St. Mary's Cathedral. And especially to thank the families, the parents who brought our young people to faith and to baptism, and now to the completion of their initiation in the sacrament of confirmation. That's one chapter of your job complete as you have brought them up to Christian adulthood in the family of God. Now a new chapter begins. They're going to need your help as much, or perhaps more than ever, as young Christian adults in the years ahead. Keep giving them your good example, encouragement in the life of faith, of prayer and worship, of virtue and holiness, and call on the Holy Spirit's help yourself in your parenting and as their families. Young candidates who have been confirmed tonight, I said to you in my homily that God comes to us again and again, especially at Mass and in the sacraments, because he wants to be part of our lives and wants you to be part of his life. Whatever the challenges ahead for you, call on the Holy Spirit's help and he will be there for you. On behalf of everyone here tonight, congratulations to our newly confirmed. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
May God the Father Almighty bless you, whom he has made his adopted sons and daughters, reborn from water and the Holy Spirit, and may he keep you worthy of his fatherly love.
Amen.
May his only begotten Son, who promised that the Spirit of truth would abide in his church, bless you and confirm you by his power in the confession of the true faith.
Amen.
May the Holy Spirit, who kindles the fire of charity in the hearts of disciples, bless you and lead you blameless and gathered as one into the joy of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless all of you who are gathered here, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth.